Samson of the hearts.
Yes, Lord, we'll bend. Oh, you're refreshing. Oh, Lord, we'll bend.
Good afternoon, good afternoon. Get out the noose, sit up the thumbs, sit up the hearts.
Oh, Lord, we'll bend.
Sit up the thumbs, sit up the hearts. Invite somebody in. Come on, come on.
Oh, Lord, we'll bend.
Sit them up, sit up the thumbs, sit up the hearts. Invite your family and friends. Come on, come on. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Come on, come on. Come on, invite your family and friends. Come on. Yeah.
Somehow he'll find a
come on. Come on, tag everyone you know. Just type in, God, you're going to always get the glory. Come on, just tag in, God, you're going to always get the glory. I need every one of y'all to please just type that in. God, you're going to always get the glory. May I get those hogs? May I get those hogs? Yeah, yeah. Now get those hoes.
He'll find a way, somehow he'll find a way.
Danger, way. Can I get that hog?
Somehow he'll find a way.
Come on. So please share this right now. And after you have shared it, just simply type in, I shared it. Come on. I need every one of y'all to please share this. Don't phony share it. Don't say you shared it, you haven't shared it. But please share this right now. And after you have shared it, just simply type in, I shared it. I'm going to give you a minute and 15 seconds, y'all. We get ready to go somewhere today, y'all. Come on. Come on, come on. Yeah, yeah. You got a minute and 15 seconds. Let me just, I feel like giving God some real praise right around here.
Come on, say.
He gonna find a way, y'all. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Some way, somehow, God will find a way. Come on, come on. About to take off right around here, y'all. Come on. God will find a way. Pick up my part. He gonna always get the glory. This is where I cut my step right around here, y'all. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, let me go ahead and get started. I'll be here all day. That's my national anthem, y'all. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Let me go ahead and get started again. I'm appreciative that you all are here. I don't take it for granted when people take out time in their busy schedule just to hear what Pastor T has to say. And for that, I say thank you. For that, I'm appreciative. Let me put this out here real quick. You're not watching this live because you're bored. You're not watching this live because you don't have anything else to do on a Sunday. You're watching this live because God has need of you. And I believe by the Spirit of God that God is going to allow what you've been believing Him for. What's going on, Prophet Eddie? He's going to allow something to be broken today. And again, I believe by the power and the authority of the Holy Ghost that you're here because what you've been believing God for, what you've been praying for, I believe that God is going to unlock it today. I'm crazy enough to believe that God's going to unlock the impossible today. So I say to you, whatever you do, don't log off prematurely, because it could be that time when you get ready to log off, could be the time when one word from God through His original prophet that caused the unlocking to take place. So again, just give God about an hour. All I want is just about an hour. If I go past an hour, continue to stay tuned. Glory to God, because I believe today's your day. Amen. With that being said, let's go. For many, says God, I just want to release this prophetic utterance. For many, says God, you're looking at 2020 as the year coming to an end, but I, says God, I'm causing a fresh alignment for many others. Says the Spirit of the living God, there's a remnant of people that I'm waking up in the spirit realm, and I'm causing them to see the season as a season of something fresh, something rejuvenated, and even something renewed. Yes, I know that 2020 has dealt many of my people some major blows, says God. But I, says God, I'm causing many others to get excited, even in the midst of what has transpired in the land, in your home, and even in your lives. Says the Spirit of the living God, in this season, I'm causing my people to come into all the way in and not half stepping, says God. This shall be the season for the full aligners, says God. God said, this is the season for the full aligners. This shall be the season in which the full aligners shall see the manifestation of their prayers coming to pass, says God. This season shall be the season in which the full aligners shall see those unanswered prayers answered in the hours, in the weeks, the days, and even the months to come, says God. Surely I shall do a new thing. As my people forget those things that have scarred them, it shall begin. As my people begin to forget those things that have caused them to operate in a place called memory recall, it shall begin. As my people understand the importance in getting to my presence, they will begin to understand the access they have and the authority of reinforcement, says God. Says God. God spoke to me and said, Terrence, when the people of God begin to understand what kind of authority that they possess, that's when they're going to see unanswered prayers answered. God said something to me earlier this week that I need to share with you all, that I need to convey to you all. And that was, He said, Terrence, I inherited every believer to compel the manifestation of their words in the earth, just as Elijah did when he called forth the rain, and as he prophesied, it caused the drought to come to an end. I know many of y'all said, man, Pastor T, you said this on several occasions about a drought coming to an end, but I'm giving you all what God gave me. God said, reintroduce them, give them an encore, and about five people, just type in. I'm only talking to five people. The rest of you all, you just eavesdropping, being nosy. But if you're one of the five that I'm talking to, I dare you right now to speak to your situation right now and begin to release a prophetic word in the comment section and just type in, my drought is coming to an end. Come on. I need about five people that really believe that thing. Just type in, my drought is coming to an end. I'm going to give you 13 seconds to type that in. Come on, just type in, my drought is coming to an end. excitement, my trial is coming to an end. Come on, my God, I feel your presence so strong, God. God, I feel your presence real strong today. I feel, God, you about to do something major. I feel you about to do something major today. So this morning, God spoke to me and said, Terrence, if the people of God grab this word, I'm going to literally cause their droughts to come to an end, even while they're watching this live. But God showed me something that was mind-blowing. And that was, it's called the secluded time with him. It's what causes the unlocking. At first, I didn't quite understand what the Holy Spirit was trying to convey to me. So God allowed my Holy Ghost fingers to do the walking. I feel Willie James Campbell right around here. God allowed my Holy Ghost fingers to do the walking. And he allowed me to stop at John chapter number 4, verses 31 through 34. I need someone to please be my personal moderator. And just type in John chapter number 4, verse 31 through 34. Come on, I need someone to type that in. Come on. Someone please be my personal moderator. John chapter number 4, verse 31 through 34. Let me give you the word of God. Verse number 31, it says, in the meantime, his disciples urged him, saying, Rabbi. Rabbi means teacher in the Jewish custom. He says, Rabbi, eat. Verse number 32. But he said to them, I have food to eat of which you don't know. So in other words, he says, he's telling the disciples, you're looking at things in the natural, but what I'm being fed is causing my spiritual awareness to be heightened. Look at verse number 33. He says, therefore, the disciples said one to another, has anyone brought him anything to eat? See, this is what we don't understand and what the disciples didn't understand. See, the disciples were thinking in terms of carnality. They were thinking in terms of in the natural. They were concerned about him eating natural food. And this is what many of us don't understand. And that is, when God is about to take us to another realm, to another dimension in him, it is vitally important that you surround yourself around people who knows how to tap into the spirit realm. Just because you have a great time together doesn't mean that that person is assigned to you spiritually. Because based on your camp, let me bless about 18 of you all, you're getting ready to now have an aha moment. You're getting ready to have an epiphany. You're getting ready to see why it could be a delay in your answered prayers. And based on your camp determines the level of your attachment. So in other words, if you're surrounded around carnal-minded people, your warfare will be a long one, because your camp doesn't understand or doesn't know how to tap into the vein of God, because they don't understand that your attacks are not carnal, but your attacks are spiritual. And when you're not spiritual, they will not understand how to fight on your behalf. And this is what God wanted me to reiterate to about 7 of you all right around here. He says, tell about 7 people that's been under attack, and it seems as if this thing has overstayed its welcome. This is what God wanted me to tell 7 people. And I need for you to type, if you're one of the 7, just type in, reinforcement is on its way. Come on, come on. I need 7 people. Please just type in, reinforcement is on its way. Come on. Come on, come on, y'all. Come on, come on, go ahead. I'm gonna give you 18 seconds for that one. Just type in, reinforcement is on its way. Come on, just type in, reinforcement is on its way. Oh, we just getting started. Don't log off just yet, y'all. We going somewhere tonight. Holy Spirit got us today for real. You are under arrest. God told me to tell you are under arrest. And you have the right to remain where you are. Because if you leave prematurely, it can cause something that you've been believing God for not to come to pass. And God said one word from his original prophet can cause things to unlock, can cause things to break, and cause things to be dismantled. So let me tell you, those of you all that's typing, the reinforcement is on its way. Let me prove my point. I need to prove my point real quick. Have you ever hung around with somebody and they begin to tell you what they were going through, and shortly thereafter, you now have the same issue as those that told you what they were going through? And that's simply because you picked up the spirit of your environment. Let me say that again. The reason why you're now under attack based on who you're around, and it's because you picked up the spirit of your environment. So if your environment is going through, guess what? You're going to go through as well. And this is what God told me to tell about seven people. He says, tell seven people, watch who you hang around with in this season. Watch your camp in this season. I don't care if it's mama. I don't care if it's daddy. I don't care if it's BFF. I don't care if it's brother. Many of you all said about seven people, you're in a place called critical. You're in a season called you can't afford to take another hit. And God said the unnecessary hit that many of you all are taking is because of the people that you are surrounded with. Look at verse number 34 in the same passage of scripture. Jesus said to them, my food is to do with the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Look at what Jesus is telling his disciples. Let me convey what he's saying. He says, where I'm going to gain my strength from is by me staying connected to the Father and by staying in his presence. In other words, Jesus is telling them, where I am, only those that are hungry for God will eat the good of the land. Look at verse number 35. He says, do you not say that I still 4 months and then comes the harvest? Behold, whenever you see the word behold, that's a prophetic announcement. He says, behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields, for they are already white for the harvest. What is Jesus conveying? Here goes a prophetic word for seven people via God's word. Seven people. You better grab this right now. What is Jesus saying? Jesus is making a prophetic announcement that you don't have to go far. Hear what I'm getting ready to tell seven people, and you're about to have an epiphany right in the middle of where you are. If you're driving, you might as well pull over right around here. Jesus is making a prophetic announcement, and he's telling you, you don't have to go far. Why you don't have to go far? Here goes seven people. Here it is what Jesus is saying. He said, your harvest is here. Come on. I need about seven people just to grab that thing. Just type in, my harvest is here. Your harvest ain't coming. Your harvest ain't coming. God want me to make this prophetic announcement and tell seven people. He said, tell seven people, your harvest is here. Come on. Come on. If you're one of the seven, you better type that thing. Hurry up. He said, your harvest is here. So in other words, you've been sowing and you haven't been reaping. You've been sowing, but you haven't been reaping. You've been sowing, but you haven't been reaping. But I come as God's mouthpiece today to tell you that God says, tell seven people, emphatically, tell them that their harvest is here. If you're one of the seven, you better say, I received that right away. Come on, come on, hurry up. Just type in, I receive it. So look what he says in verse number 36. Let me hurry up, y'all, because I feel something dropping already. I feel something dropping already. Look at what he says in verse number 36. Look at verse number 36. Verse number 36, look what it says. He says, and he who reaps receives wages and gather fruit for eternal life, that both he who sows and he who reaps may rejoice together. Look at what God is saying. He's saying that the sowers and the reapers are about to rejoice together. Ooh, I'm trying to keep my composure. I'm trying to get through this word right around here. He says that the sowers and the reapers, my God, y'all making some noise in here. He said the sowers and the reapers are about to rejoice together. So what is Jesus talking about? He's telling them, this is about souls, really. He said the wages are equivalent to souls. So in other words, Jesus is telling them emphatically. He's saying the greatest pay that you can receive is by snatching souls from the hands of the enemy. And this is what you and I don't understand. This is what you and I, what we don't understand. And that is, when you're working for God, come on, come on, I need to stand up right around here. When you're working for God, he's the best employee that you can work for. So can you imagine? Come on, I need you to go on prophetic wings of imagination right around here. So can you imagine every soul that you snatch from the hands of the enemy is equivalent to $1 million? All right, y'all gonna miss this. Y'all gonna miss this because y'all thinking it's about money. This ain't about money. This is about your faith. This is about sowing. and this is about upgrading to the next round. So again, I'm not saying that what's going to happen, but what I am saying is God is saying your labor of doing what he's called you to do will not go in vain. Look at verse number 37 to back my claim up. It says, and this is said is true. Look at verse number 37. It says, one sows and another reap. One sow and another reap. Look at what Jesus said in verse number 38. And Ladon, look what he says. He says, I sent you to reap that for which you have not labored, Tremaine. He says that others have labored and you have entered into their labor. Come on, I need y'all to grab this right around here. I need y'all to grab this. This is what God is really conveying. God is really saying this. So in other words, what is Jesus really saying? Jesus is saying, when you're walking in extreme obedience and doing what God has called you to do, in essence, God is saying, for my sold out believers, those that are not serving me, come on, y'all need to grab this. Those that are not serving me, don't have a relationship with me. God says, eight people, I don't know where you are, but I pray you ain't driving because something about to break right around here. God said, for those people that don't serve me, that don't worship me, that are pseudo Christians, God says, you are about to reap their harvest. All right. So in other words, look what God is really conveying. God is saying, I seen your work. I seen your sowing. And then you got some people on the sideline. They're selling drugs. They're doing all damnable things. And you looking and saying, man, God, what about me? God told me to tell about eight people. Tell them what you have stepped into. You have stepped into a season called sweatless equity. All right. Did y'all hear what I just conveyed? He says, you have stepped into a season called sweatless equity. All right. Maybe I'm going too fast. Let me sit down because maybe me standing up is causing y'all to get nervous. So in other words, he said, it's in a season called sweatless equity. I heard God saying this. He said, this prophet Eddie, he says, I'm getting ready. In other words, this is what sweatless equity is all about. He says, I'm getting ready to hand deliver you the spoils of the unbelievers. Woo! I can't sit down, y'all. Something is brewing. God is saying, I'm getting ready to hand deliver you the spoils of the unbelievers. In other words, the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the righteous. You've been praying, you've been fasting, you've been giving, but you haven't been seeing. But I come as God's original prophet, and I came to make a prophetic announcement to let you know this is that season to reap your harvest. All right. Y'all ain't ready for this. Okay. Y'all ain't ready. Maybe I'm going too fast. Let me slow down. Maybe I'm going too fast. Look at this. Let me share something with y'all. I got a daughter on here, and I want to share her testimony, because the Bible says in the book of Revelations, in the book of around chapter number 12, I believe, it says they were overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the words of their testimony. Let me share this with y'all. And this is the power. I need to share this testimony right around here. I have a daughter on here by the name of Tasha Williams. And she hates when I call her name out. But guess what? Faith ain't fair. Shut up. So, Tasha's been with us for a long period of time. And I believe right around in this season, she now gets it. That when God allow his prophet to speak, you respond. You don't respond based on what you feel. You based on responding based on faith. So look at this. The first time she responded, she only had $1. But she know that when God allows her pastor to speak, she respond based off what her pastor says. So she sold this $1. And I began to release the prophetic word as she sold, that in the next day, God's going to do something major. He's going to unlock some things. How come the exact next day, I believe it was the next day, the exact next day, her daughter received multiple scholarships that, watch this now, that she didn't even apply for most of them. One of them is for one of the top schools here in Chicago, a full ride. The scholarship is worth almost $100,000, a full ride to one of the top schools here in Chicago. So let me show you something. I keep telling y'all, giving this from the heart. And my mess ain't got to do with the money, but I just need to stop right here. So look what happened. So Pastor Brenna began to release a prophetic word over her life a couple of days ago. And she told her that God was about to allow a secret donor to wipe out all of her tuition. A secret donor. These were the exact words that Pastor Sabrina conveyed to Tasha Williams. Look at this now. Not that many days thereafter, she gets a call. She gets a call and said, a secret donor want to zero out all of your student loan, all of your tuition, want to zero them out. Yesterday, Tasha sent me the letter of the secret donor saying the scholarships, the debts are zeroed out. All I want is a thank you card or a Christmas card saying Merry Christmas. And this is what I just heard God say. He said, I've just released and what you call a ripple anointing. God says, tell this to our people. If they understand what's getting ready to be released, God says before December the 31st get here, he's going to zero out all of your major bills. As a matter of fact, God said, release this over two people. He says, tell two people the debts that you had in 2020, you ain't going into 2021 with. I just heard God say, the debts that you got in 2020, they will not transfer into 2021. Now, I don't know who the two people I'm speaking to, but I dare you to receive it, because I heard God say two people. As a matter of fact, many of you all, I'm going to give you a number. If you begin to add up all of your debts, you got a debt of about $75,000. And I just heard God say, tell about two people. Tell them I'm getting ready to zero out all of their debts this year. And God got less than 12 days to perform that which he promised. If you receive it, just type in, I receive it. If you receive it, just type in, I receive it. Come on, come on. I'm trying to keep my composure, y'all. If you receive it, just type in, I receive it. Come on, come on. I hear God say, my favor is being unlocked on this live. I hear God say, my favor is being unlocked on this live. He says, tell this thy people, those that's been sowing and you have not reaped. I hear God saying, I'm getting ready to give you evidence that your sowing is about to pay off. I just heard God say, tell seven people. He says, tell them that their sowing is about to pay off. Now, you can think this is about hocus pocus if you want to log off. But I'm telling you, as God's mouthpiece, again, I will never, I don't know about them other prophets, but I will never, ever use God's name in vain for my own personal gain. If I'm telling you God said it, God in all of heaven is going to back me up. So look what God says. Now, right around here, I need you all. This ain't got nothing to do with your tithes and offering. If you believe the word of the prophet right here, I dare you to sow right now. I dare you to sow right now. Sow right now. Pause what you're doing. And I dare you to sow right now. Come on. Come on, right around here, I dare you to sow. Come on, right around here, I dare you to sow. Right around here, sow. I'm going to give you 93 seconds to sow right around here. Right around here, I'm gonna tell you. Come on. Yeah! Come on. I dare you to sow something you can't afford. I dare you to sow something you can't afford. And watch God break the back of debt. Watch God break the back of poverty. Watch God do it. Hey, Sunday, come on, come on. I dare you right now. This is fertile ground. This is good ground. This is holy ground. All of heaven is going to back me up today. Sunday, Rebananamansi. New houses, new cars. And if you got the faith to believe in, God said, I give you a car with the title all at once. Come on. Come on. Say, heaven is descending. It's coming down to you personally. I got to get to a place, y'all. So what is Jesus conveying in John chapter number 4? In this passage of scripture, he's saying, there's a place in me that I'm trying to get my people into. And once they understand the importance of getting there, then and only then will they see the flowing of the Lord called, watch this now, the flowing of the Lord, which is called milk and honey. So God is speaking to me in all this week about total surrenderance. Somebody just type in total surrenderance. Come on, somebody just type in total surrenderance. So look what God says. God says this about total surrenderance. Look at this. He said, Terrence, what people don't understand, and that is, once they totally surrendered to me, regardless of what they are going through. He said their total surrenderance says, regardless of what I have going on in my life, I would not allow what I'm going through to cause me to become distracted again. Regardless of what I feel and how I feel, I refuse to allow it to become a burden. The place of presence is the place of surrendering. Let me say that again. The place of present is the place of surrender. I need to say that one more time. The place of presence is the place of surrender. Let me pause right here. I need to pause right here. We at halftime. I need every one of you all to do me one huge favor. I know you may have did it once, but I need you to do it again. I need every one of y'all to please share this again. You may have shared it once, but somebody just logged on your page being nosy. We're about to give them something to watch. I need every one of y'all to please share this again. And after you have shared it, just simply type in, I shared it. I'm going to give you 90 seconds. Come on. I'm going to give you 90 seconds. Come on. Share it again. Come on. Come on. Come on. Share it again. Come on. Come on. 90 seconds. Share it. I need you to share it for real. Come on. You got 45 more seconds. Come on. God, we give you praise. God, we give you glory. We give you praise, God. Come on. I haven't got there yet. And this is what we as believers must get a revelation on. I want to give y'all this revelation. We get a revelation on, and that is when you dare to dive deep into a lifestyle of prayer, then prayer will cause, look what prayer is getting ready to cause. Prayer will now start or will cause a plowing that will cause a massive opening of fields of harvest. And watch this now, an uncapped well of riches and sustaining power. And for this reason alone, this is why, let me bless you all with this, Poppy. For this reason alone, this is why the enemy don't want you to pray. For this reason alone, the enemy doesn't want you to invest in your prayer life. For this reason alone, this is why when you make up in your mind that you're about to pray, that's when it seems like you're going to experience the best sleep of your life. And if you follow the life of Jesus, Jesus understood the power of prayer. I need about 8 people just to type in, God, increase my prayer life. Come on. 8 people just type in, God, increase my prayer life. Come on. 8 people just type in, God, increase my prayer life. Come on. Y'all know I'm not going to stay in that thing too long. Just type in, God, increase my prayer life. Just type in, God, increase my prayer life. So look what God is saying. And for this reason alone, that's when you made up in your mind, you got to follow like the life after Jesus. And if you follow the life of Jesus, Jesus understood the power of prayer. Regardless of how many demons he had to face during that day, Jesus understood before he can get to his next assignment, he had to isolate himself with the Father. Jesus, so was in the midst of what he experiencing, doing what he was performing. He had a supernatural strength in the midst of the test, in the midst of the trials, in the midst of the lies, in the midst of the opposition. There was something that kept him from quitting. And this is what I heard God say for 8 people. When you understand the power of prayer, you won't quit. When you understand the power of prayer, you understand I can't throw in the towel. There's something that no matter how hard that Jesus labored, he says, I need to isolate myself with the Father because I need a refreshing. And this is what God is saying. The reason why the enemy is weighing many of you all out is because you don't understand the power of prayer. And this is what I heard God saying. When you learn how to tap into the presence of God, you automatically pick up the spirit of Jesus. What is that? You pick up, this is the spirit when you tap into the place of prayer. And I'm just about done. When you understand the power of prayer, you pick up a nevertheless spirit. Let me say that again. I don't know if y'all heard what I just said. When you pick up the spirit of Jesus, you pick up the nevertheless spirit. What is a nevertheless spirit? A nevertheless spirit says this: not my will, but thy will be done. A nevertheless spirit says, I don't care how many times I've been denied, I believe that this time I will get the answers I've been waiting for. A nevertheless spirit says, I don't care how many times I got a negative report, it's something about this time God is about to flip the script. A nevertheless spirit says, I don't care how many no's I've gotten, this next time I go in is going to say you've been approved. A nevertheless spirit says, I don't care how many times I've sown and I didn't see my harvest, but it's something about this sowing, I'm about to reap a massive harvest. I need about 8 people. Please just type in nevertheless. Come on, 8 people, just type in nevertheless. Just type in nevertheless. Come on, just type in nevertheless. Hey, my God, I feel your presence. My God, I feel your presence. Come on, just type in nevertheless. Come on, just type in nevertheless. Come on, just type in nevertheless. Come on, come on, come on. Just type in nevertheless. Just type in nevertheless. Come on, just type in nevertheless. Come on, keep typing nevertheless. Keep typing nevertheless. Conclusion. He says, this is what God spoke to me. He says, Terrence, tell this to our people. He said, if my people give a revelation of sticking with me, even when things are going topsy-turvy, that's when their greatest breakthrough is about to happen. Let me bless y'all with this. Doing, D-O-I-N-G, is the result of being. Many people, many of us, we've gotten this backwards. Come on, I want y'all to hear what I'm saying, y'all. Don't just hear me. I need y'all to hear me. In other words, God says, they tried to live out destiny by just doing. They do great exploits for Jesus. They're doing. They reach people for Jesus. They're doing. They look for fulfillment by laboring. They're doing. While all of that is true, there's something so fulfilling in working with and for the Father. It's also dangerous to just labor without having a relationship. It becomes, let me tell you what it becomes. It becomes a yoke of bondage instead of an extension of identity. Did y'all hear what I just said? Can I say that again? When you're just doing, yeah, you're doing great exploits for Jesus. You're reaching the masses for Jesus. You're doing everything. You're prophesying in his name. You're casting out demons in his name. You're doing all of those things. But God says, where's the relationship? He says, if you don't have a relationship, in essence, everything that you're doing, it's like a yoke of bondage instead of extension of identity. Yes, you're known as an eighth world wonder. You're known as a person that will give the shirt off your back, but you're doing works, but you lack the relationship. Because God says, when you have a for real relationship with me, you don't isolate me. When you have a real relationship with me, you just don't just want to prophesy. You want to spend some time with me. And if you study the life of Jesus, Jesus understood that I just can't just do all of this because people are going to drain me. He said, so in other words, I can't lose my identity as a man that opened up the eyes, a man that just healed the sick. I need to know that me and my Father, we are one. So in other words, many of us, we're doing religion. We have a religious mindset, but we lack a kingdom mindset. When you have a kingdom mindset, you understand before anything is released, I will make sure that I have the approval of the Father versus what I feel. And this is the revelation that God gave me about having a lifestyle of consecration, and I'm done. And that is, as we come into full understanding of being sold out for God, it's something that innates in us. So in other words, when we become one with God, one with Jesus, we'll start talking like him. When we become one with Jesus, we'll start doing the same thing that Jesus did. What did the word of God say? He says, greater works shall ye do. We ain't just talking about healing the sick, raising the dead. Do you not know that prayer is one of the works that we must do? Isolating yourself, building yourself in your most holy faith, having a for real relationship with God is something that you must do. So in other words, he said, yes, Jesus raised the dead, so shall you. Yes, Jesus opened up the blinded eyes, so shall we do it. Jesus stopped the woman from bleeding for 12 long years, so shall we do. And so God saying, he says, I don't want you just to do, I need you to spend some time with me. And I'm under this persuasion that Jesus wasn't just doing for the sake of doing. His doing was an extension of him being. Did y'all hear what I just said? His doing was an extension of him being. Did y'all hear what I just said? His extension of doing was an extension of him being. So in other words, Jesus says, not only am I going to do, but I'm going to be as well. What did Acts chapter number 17, verse number 28 says? Let me tell you what it says. He says, for in him we live and move and have our being. So Jesus said, I'm just not going to just do. I'm going to be doing some other things. It's going to be a part of my being. And so we hear that part of the scripture, but we leave the latter part out. We tend to read, in him we live, we move, and we have our being. But this is the part of the scripture that we miss out. And the latter part of that scripture says this. It says this. It says, and some of you by your own poets have said, we are his offspring. So in other words, because we are children of God, made in his image, everything that Jesus had access to, so do you and I. And God is saying, when you don't know who you are, you operate in a place called limitations. But when you understand whose you are and who you are, you now understand that you are a joint heir who understands I have access. In other words, no limited access, but full access. Eight people, just type in, I got full access. Come on. Eight people, just type in, I got full access. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on. Eight people, just type in, I got full access. Ooh, my, my, my. Ooh. Eight people, just type in, I got full access. I don't want just crumbs, I want the whole loaf. I don't want just crumbs, I want the whole loaf. I don't want just snippets, I want the whole thing. I no longer want sneak previews, I want the full movie. I want full access. Because I'm a joint heir, I've been adopted. Oh my, Rosande, da-da-da banshee. Everything about me is changing. My language is changing. My garment is changing. But the spirit of heaviness put on a garment of praise. What I had on earlier was keeping me locked down because I was trying to be conservative. So I had to change it to something that was comfortable so I can praise God, which can cause me to give God an ugly praise, which can cause me to give God a ridiculous praise. Ooh. So look what God says. When you believe in God for something, eight people, hear what I'm getting ready to unlock. He said, it shall happen. Eight people, please just type in, it shall happen. All right. All right. Y'all tired of me. I'm done. Y'all tired of me. I'm done. Y'all tired of me. I'm done. I'm done. Y'all tired of me. Eight people, just type it, it shall happen. Oh my, Rose Sunday, it shall happen. It shall happen. It shall happen. It shall happen. I need to release this prophetic word, y'all. But I need y'all to give me eight good more minutes. Eight good more minutes. If all of y'all want me to go a little further, if you give me eight good minutes, just type in, keep preaching, Pastor T. Come on, I need at least about 10 people to tell me to keep preaching. Come on, come on. 8 people just tell me to keep preaching, Pastor T. Because I need to release this prophetic utterance. Because I believe there's something about to unlock when I release this prophetic utterance. Come on, it shall happen. Oh, my. Come on, it shall happen. COVID got to let you go. Shortness of breath got to let you go. Diabetes got to let you go. Rheumatoid arthritis got to let you go. Poverty got to let you go. Acid reflux got to let you go. Swelling of body parts got to let you go. The spirit of gluttony got to let you go. Depression got to let you go. Hatred got to let you go. Because God said it shall happen. It's about to let you go. So God took me to his word, y'all. I got 8 minutes. Somebody time me. I got 8 minutes. So God took me to his word. And he said, Terrence, remind my people about unfathomed situations that happened with Mary. Here it is. You have Mary who could not possibly imagine that she would be the woman that would bear a child by the name of Jesus. Let alone conceiving him without the assistance of a man. Come on. I'm getting ready to show y'all how God's getting ready to drop unfathomed miracles around this season. So keep in mind that Mary was a virgin, which means she wasn't touched by a man. was informed. Look at this guy. I need y'all to hear what I'm getting ready to say. Keep in mind that Mary was a virgin, which means she wasn't touched by a man, but was informed that she was about to have a child. Let me say that again. I need y'all to hear what I'm getting ready to convey. I need y'all to turn y'all awareness up right around here. Mary was a virgin. She wasn't touched by a man, but she was informed that she's about to have a child without a man. Now, the last I checked, the only way a child is going to come into this world, that means some intimacy has to take place. So here it is, after hearing this prophetic word that she was about to bear a child. Now watch this now. This was prophesied even before Mary was born. Did y'all hear what I just said? What was prophesied about Mary carrying a child happened even before Jesus stepped on the scene physically. The prophet Isaiah prophesied the details of Jesus' arrival. So in other words, before she became informed, it was already formed. Let me say that again. Before she became informed, it was already formed. And this is what I heard God say. Even before your mama met your daddy, God already had plans for you to prosper. Even with all of your mistakes that still didn't catch God by surprise, God says, I knew you were going to make that mistake even before you did it. And God says, your mistakes didn't change my mind concerning your destiny. As a matter of truth, God is saying your mistakes is going to be the very thing that's going to cause others to come out of what they're going through. God is saying, you don't have to broadcast who hurts you anymore. You don't have to write a book of who scarred you. He says, simply let God redefine your story. He says, all people gonna find out is that you a survivor. All people gonna know is that you survived the worst season of your life. See, some people can't handle your story. And that's what they're waiting on. And that's for you to tell your story. But God is saying, some things are better left out, and the only thing they ain't going to witness, and that is the glory of the Lord is upon you. And this is why you must get into the presence of God, because it's in the presence of God is the fullness of joy. It's in the presence of God where you learn to hear the voice and his instructions for your life. So in other words, it is the being, the B-E-I-N-G. It is the being, the B-E-I-N-G, it is the being in the midst of him and the fullness of his presence that we pray earth-shaking prayers. You want to know the heartbeat of God? Let me bless you all with this. You want to know the heartbeat of God? Get in his presence. Powerful prayers are birthed from a place of intimacy. You just can't know the voice of God without developing a prayer life. I need about 8 people just to type in, God, increase my prayer life. Come on. 8 people just type in, God, increase my prayer life. Come on. Come on. 8 people just type in, God, increase my prayer life. Come on. Just type in, God, increase my prayer life. People who are powerful, let me bless you with this. People who are powerful in the realm of the spirit are surrendered and established in the presence of God. In other words, they understand, the people that have a prayer life, they understand that being in his presence is their reward. Let me say that again. People that have a sold out and a for real prayer life, they understand that being in the presence of God is their reward. They pray in the presence of God. They worship in the midst of his glory. They rule and reign as kingdom ambassadors dwelling in the throne room. Let me say that again. People that have a prayer life, They understand they pray in the presence of God, number one. Number two, they worship in the midst of his glory. Number three, they rule and reign as kingdom ambassadors dwelling in the throne room. So God is saying, Terrence, if you want to see earth-shattering miracles take place, tell my people, get in my presence. If you want me to, if they need their plans revealed for their next, tell them, get in my presence. If you want to see the weight of God's glory fall, get in my presence. If America wants to return back to dominance, tell America, get in my presence. All right. Luke chapter number 5, verses 15 to 16. I ain't got time to exegete it. Let me just tell you what it's about. Here it is. They're talking about spreading the news. So in other words, Jesus understood if he was going to do anything, he had to isolate himself in prayer. Now I release prophetic utterance. For the next 3 minutes, let me prophesy. I want to release this prophetic utterance for the next 3 minutes. This is what God gave me. I want to release this prophetic utterance. Let me wipe the sweat off my brow because I'm getting ready to go hard for these next 3 minutes. Says the Spirit of the living God, this is the hour in which I will pour out my spirit upon those that are hungry and are thirsty. For I said, God, in my word, they that hunger and thirst after me shall not only be filled, but they shall never run dry again, says God. In this season and in this hour, says God, I'm pouring out a fresh wine and a fresh wind. Says the Spirit of the living God, I'm pouring out a fresh wine and a fresh wind. Said the Spirit of the living God, I'm pouring out a fresh wine and a fresh wind. Just as I did at the feast of the wedding, I'm pouring out fresh wine, says God. Said the Spirit of the living God, I shall release it, I shall reestablish you, and then I will reinvent you, says God. Let me say that again. He says, I shall release it, I shall reestablish you, and then I will reinvent you, says God. Said the Spirit of the living God, I am releasing my glory upon you for your reestablishment. And as I reestablish you, I will reinvent you, says God. And the reason why I am doing it in those phases so that you will understand the process of what's about to take place, says God. In my releasing, says God, I'm causing my spirit to overwhelm you so to the point that you will begin to drown out what you know. And when I release my glory, it's going to remove all of the residue of your past. When I release my glory, it's going to create in you a cleaner heart, says God. When I release my glory, it's going to remove the stain of your mistakes, says God. When I release my glory, it's going to cause a reawakening. It's going to cause a reawakening for your spiritual desires. Woo. When I release my glory, then I'm going to reestablish you. And upon me reestablishing you, I am surrounding you around people who will have a greater appreciation of your wisdom, your knowledge, and your understanding, says God. Says the Spirit of the living God, for many of y'all, this is why you couldn't go deep in my presence. And that's because you had people surrounding you that didn't want more of me. And for that reason, that's why you couldn't remain consistent in my presence. But in my reestablishing you, I'm placing a greater demand of my glory upon you. So when people see you, when people hear you, they will see me, says God. And when they see you, their respect for you will never ever be in a place called common ever again. But in my reestablishing you, says God, I'm placing a greater demand on you. In this reestablishment, is going to cause you to appreciate me, God, more, says God. Because you're taking me for granted, says God. Because of our relationship that we had developed. And because of our developed relationship, even you felt like you didn't need to pray anymore. You felt like you didn't need to fast anymore. You felt like you didn't need to study. You feel like you didn't even need to give like you used to. And that's simply because you too had gotten common with me, says God. But God says, never again. Don't take me for granted. Finally, says God, I will reinvent you. Finally, says God, I will reinvent you. Meaning that many people know the old you, but they don't know the revised you. Let me say that again. God said, I'm about to reinvent you. Many people know the old you, but they don't know the revised you. Says the Spirit of the living God, in this quarantine season, I am reestablishing your name in the earth. Says the Spirit of the living God, in this quarantine season, I am reigniting your fire. And this time, it will never go out. And that's simply because you know what it felt like to be in the wilderness. And because it was the wilderness is where you almost died. And to some degree, you did die. It was spiritual death. And because you cried out to me when you were in the wilderness and asked me to restore your fire, I did. And that's why, says God, I am reinventing you. And in this reinvention, you will always wear the garment of humility. Says the Spirit of the living God, it is the time to release what I have been working in you for the greater weight of my glory that is yet to be seen will be released from my people upon the earth through you. Oh God, says the Spirit of the living God, because I released you, I am reestablishing you, and now I am reinventing you. I am, says God, I'm placing a greater anointing upon you in this season. And because of this greater anointing, and because of this greater anointing that's been released upon you, you shall never, ever get weary or get lost in the desert again. You shall never, ever get lost in the wilderness again. You shall never, ever get lost in the wilderness again. The reason why you will never get lost in the wilderness again, simply because you know what it feels like, and you vow, says God, if you ever bring me up out of this muck and mire, you promise not to ever return back to that place again. And God says, I heard your reestablished covenant to me, and I will hold you to your word, says God. Says the Spirit of the living God, as many of y'all have witnessed, many of those who have called upon my name face unfathomed difficulties. But when it's time for their purpose to come, I equipped them, I anointed them, I strengthened them, and I did greater feats through them. All of the men and the women had weaknesses just like you and I. But when it was time for my glory to be revealed in the earth, I had to show their weakness to the world. This is why God said, he said, I had to show your weaknesses to people that took you for granted. They saw your scars. They saw your imperfections. They witnessed your sin. They witnessed your failures. They witnessed your error. But this is what God is saying to about 8 of you all. He says, I allowed them to see your weaknesses so they know that it was not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit that all of these miracles were being done. So shall it be in the days ahead, says God. Says the Spirit of the living God, just like Samson gained strength in his weakness to fulfill his destiny, which I spoken through the angels to his mother, so I will strengthen you for the days of your purpose. So be not weary in well-doing. You shall accomplish that which I sent you out to do. You shall reap because you shall faint not, says God. Says the Spirit of the living God, as I am releasing, I'm reestablishing, I'm reinventing you. I'm calling my sheep who have known my voice, and another they will not follow. And I'm giving them, hear what God says, I'm giving them new names. Says the Spirit of the living God, many of my called, set apart ones, you have been scattered, but I will begin to call the faithful ones out of that place of solitude, and I will feed them myself and speak truth to them, so that they may decree and declare what they heard or what they hear in the spirit realm. I, says God, I am releasing your name in the earth. And what I'm releasing is not related to the old nature, but will be the new nature, says God. You shall be called my bold ones, my fiery ones, and you shall be called the harvest. Yes, you will be called my healers, my deliverers in this hour and in this season. No longer shall you be ashamed based off your past, your fears, or your failures. You shall be mine in the days, and men and women in the earth will know you by your great exploits that I shall do through you, says God. Yes, you, says God, you will be strong and do great exploits in the earth in the days to come. Finally, says God, in the last month of this year and even in the beginning months of next year, we're about to step into a season like the apostles were in, a day of uncertainty about what happens in our countries, in our states, in our household, in our families, in our children, and even in our ministries. In many cases, many of us are about to go into another, what we call a quarantine, for real hard shut in. And like the apostles of old, who feared and had gripped many of their hearts. But I, says God, I have seen all that you have gone through even right now. But I want you to know that I'm about to do something amazing in the days to come. This is what I hear God saying, and I'm done. Where you are is a transitioning and a resetting. Says God, where you are is a transitioning and a resetting. Where you are, says God, is a transitioning and a resetting. Says the Spirit of living God, there is a shaking. There is a rumbling. There is a shaking. There is a rumbling going on. And it is because I am preparing you for the hills or the mountains of the Lord. God says, I'm preparing you for the hills and the mountains of the Lord. All right. I got to finish this prophetic utterance. I got to finish this. I have to finish this. He says, I'm preparing you for the hills and the mountains of the Lord. Just like my word says in Psalms 24, verse number 3, the word heal. Let me tell y'all prophetically what the word heal means. I need someone to type this in. Heal. H-I-L-L. Prophetically speaking, the word heal means promotion. Prophetically speaking, the word heal, H-I-L-L, means promotion. God is not trying to kill us in our testing season. No. God says, I haven't tested you even though you've been sick. He said, there wasn't a test to kill you. In essence, God says, the testing that you were in was a testing to promote you. In other words, test brings about promotion. Test brings promotion as they cleanse you, making us ready to be the vessels for a clearer, pure water of his word to flow through us. And God says, I will not use you filthy. I want to cleanse you. What you're going through in this season is a season of cleansing. Just like I said in my word in 1 Peter chapter number 4, verse number 12 through 13. Beloved, do not think that it's strange concerning the fiery trials, which is to try you, as though some strange things happen to you. But rejoice. Hey, people, just type in, but rejoice. But rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's suffering, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. Yes, the keys to going through these trials is to understand that he's bringing you to a place like Joseph. You going from the pit to the palace. You going from the pit to the palace. In other words, God is saying, you've been promoted. I'm done. You've been promoted. You've been promoted like Joseph. You've been promoted, says God. You've been promoted. God had to take Joseph. He took him out of the prison and trials that tried him for years and finally brought him up to a second in command to Pharaoh. So you mean to tell me Joseph went from being in the pit, from being looked upon like peasant, like a dog, to being second command to his adversary? God was all this time getting things out of him so that he would be able to use him during the famine to save those who put him in bondage. Let me bless about 8 people and I'm done for real. God says, yes, you may not have what you want to have. And yes, it may look like you're dependent on people that have it, but they won't bless you. God said, go through this season with joy. As a matter of fact, he said, exceeding joy. He says, in the days and the weeks to come, I'm getting ready to cause a momentum turnaround, says God. He says, what I'm getting ready to do, I'm getting ready to cause a momentous transitioning, says God. Says the Spirit of the living God, yes, I have been preparing you in the shaking and in the fiery trials so that we can be the city that's set on the hill for such a time as this. Says the Spirit of the living God, so go through this season. Stop complaining. Don't murmur, but rejoice in this. He is taking you to this place. He is bringing you to the promotions of the Lord for such a time as this, says God. God says, your trials and your tribulations has qualified you to be promoted. Shandro Manadabanche. There's somebody right now, you're watching me right now. You've been in a place called liminal. You've been in a place called topsy-turvy. And one of the reasons why you're in this place called topsy-turvy and in a place called liminal is because you are at a place. I need 3 people to hear what I'm getting ready to convey. The reason why you're in this place is because where you are have brought you as far as they can take you. And many of you all, you are there at a place called false loyalty. You're more loyal to man than you are to God. And you're not just watching this live because you're bored. You're watching this live because God is speaking to you right now. God is speaking to you and tell you that this is your next place. This is the place where God says, I'm taking you to your Elijah. I'm taking you to your Elijah, the people that has the ability to take you to your next. And that's the reason why you're at a place called frustration. That's the reason why you're at a place called, man, I need to hear from God, but I don't know where to go. God is speaking to you right now. There are about 3 people that I'm talking to right now. I hear God saying, you're at a backslidden state. 2 people I'm talking to. There are 2 people that I'm talking to. There's somebody that needs to rededicate their life to Christ. And then there's somebody that is watching me right now. God has you watching it because he said, this is where I'm calling you to. I'm calling you to sit on this great ministry. This is your next place. You've been saying, God, where? God said, your where has now. This is your where. So if you need to surrender your life to Christ, just type in, Pastor T, I want to surrender my life to Christ. Or if you already saved and say, Pastor T, I want to be a part of this ministry, type that in. 3 people that I know that I'm talking to right now, type that in the comment. 1, type in, I want to surrender my life to this. I want to surrender my life to Christ. Or you've already saved, you want to be a part of this ministry, you need a greater covering. Not just a covering, but you need to sit down with somebody who's going to help you get to your next. That's you right now. Intercessors, begin to pray. I need you to surrender now. Come on, begin to pray. 3 people, God is speaking to you right now. No more delay. No more delay. No more delay. What are you waiting for? Type in the comment section.
What are you waiting for? It's time to rise.
It's time to rise up.
What are you waiting for?
What are you waiting for?
Go and possess it.
Come on.
What are you waiting for?
Type in the comment section. I want to be a part of this ministry. Come on. Or say, I want to surrender my life to Christ. Come on. Come on.
What are you waiting for?
Come on.
It's time to rise.
Come on.
What are you waiting for? It's time to get up. What are you waiting for?
Come on.
Time to go forth. Possess the land, possess the land.
Three people that's watching me right now, come on.
Possess the land, possess the land, possess the land, possess the land. It's yours for the taking.
Don't be embarrassed. We've all said where you sit. We all said where you sitting. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. No more delays. Come on. God is speaking to you right now. Come on. You need someone to cover you. Come on. Not covet you, but cover you. Come on. It's a terrible thing to live in hell and die and go to hell. God is speaking right now. Tomorrow's not promised us. As a matter of fact, this next hour is not promised us. Come on. Disciple, I want to surrender my life to Christ. Come on. Word bless you. I pray this word bless you. For those of y'all that are coming on the tail end, I dare you, I triple dog dare you to rewatch this again. The anointing of God was on this live. And follow, if you, when, as you be watching, type in, follow the instructions. I'm telling you, the anointing of God was over here. I dare you to sow right now. I dare you to sow even as you're watching this. I dare you. If this message blessed you, I dare you to sow. I dare you to sow into this anointing. It's Pastor T, y'all. I'm out of here. If you enjoyed this word, just type it, I enjoyed this word, Pastor T. If you enjoyed this word, just type it, I enjoyed this word, Pastor T. Come on, come on. It's ours, God. No more delays. No more delays. Yes, God.
He's releasing miracles.
Yes, God.
Miracle signs and wonders.
Oh, oh.
Miracle signs and wonders.
Yeah.
Miracle signs and wonders.
Oh, oh, oh.
Miracle signs and wonders.
Oh, oh. He's releasing miracle signs and wonders. When you get into the presence of God, take your consecration to another level. You're going to see those miracles happen. It's Pastor T, y'all. I'm out of here, y'all. You be blessed. It's going to happen.